The Seven Deadly Sins is a shallow anime. Who says that? Escanor is a bland character that's only liked because he's badass. Who decides that? The only one truly fit to decide these things is me. Or well, anyone watching this video, after you're done, feel free to take an educated pot shot at it in the comments. And I really appreciate all you guys calling me Lord Nuxenor in the last video. Definitely made my day. Don't know how it started, don't know how many of you thought of it at the same time, but congrats, fam. I was out-memed. I've been doing quite a few analyses on the Seven Deadly Sins recently for two reasons. One, I'm enjoying it, and two, no one else is. So, when I asked you on my analysis of the Escanor versus Esterosa fight, which honestly went maybe a little too in-depth if you wanted me to decode the philosophy of Escanor, I was surprised by how much positive feedback I got for that idea. He's a loved character, absolutely, but most of that is a credit to his superficial role in the narrative as the ultimate prideful badass. So while I love him for that, I respect him even more for his depth as one of my favorite anime characters of all time. Being different, Escanor has been ostracized from his community at a very young age. A past not all that uncommon in the realm of anime, but unfortunately not all that uncommon in the realm of reality and in the realm of society. Especially if that difference is a positive attribute. In your average story, when someone's excommunicated, it's due to their difference in race or in physical features, but very seldom is it due to their greatest strengths. Escanor was an outcast largely due to jealousy, and Escanor knew that, already feeding his pride at a very young age. Pride is a terrible attribute, easily one of the most devastating of all of the seven sins, and one of the most commonly found in people. As far as lust, greed, envy, wrath, sloth, or gluttony, these are, in a sense, relatable. Because it's completely understandable why someone would have these flaws, and to an extent we all do. But pride stands above all others in this exact sense. It's not relatable, and it's hated when found in others close to you. And that is due to the pure nature of this carnal sin. Pride, by definition, thinks of itself to exist without sin. Recognizing oneself to be too prideful is in itself a lack of pride. So Escanor, the sin and embodiment of pride, never once claims to have a pride issue. Just like Meliodas never talks about having wrath issues, but the difference lies in the fact that Meliodas internally understands his wrath issue and constantly works to overcome it, whereas Escanor, even internally, does not feel flawed in this sense. He feels a genuine pity for others, and this is a pity for everyone else less than him. Friend or foe. Everything weaker than him is deserving of this pity. Obviously, it's so viewers can trace back to an overabundance of pride, but to Escanor himself, it cannot, because once again, tracing it back to the flaw of pride is in itself a lack of pride. It's an odd conundrum that can't really exist outside the realm of the Seven Deadly Sins anime, but that's one of the reasons why I love it among so many others. Because since they have total control over their own absolute universe, they can create any philosophical paradox they desire. And that's not to mention character ideology. I've been reading quite a bit of psychology recently, mostly for the sake of making these videos. I even made friends with a psych student, which is the weirdest friendship in the universe, being that we're doing the same thing, aspiring for the two most opposite jobs on the phase of the planet. But psychoanalyzing Escanor is really not all that difficult once you know where to start. Being that he grew up as a total outcast because of his difference, this almighty sense of pride kicked in as a bandage to his social wounds, where he cut off his feelings towards others, nearly pitying them all. But in all, Escanor has a fascinating dynamic that's constantly causing his philosophy to fluctuate. At night, when there's no reason for him to be prideful whatsoever, being that he's a total wuss, he's extraordinarily grateful for his newfound friends being the sins, and he truly loves the other members of his little group of weirdos, just like I love and appreciate the fan base, my little group of weirdos. And please note, to make life easier for the rest of this video, I will be referring to Day Escanor as Tall Bright, and Night Escanor as Small Bright. So while Tall Bright has pride to use as an emotional cushion, Small Bright had nothing, and that made him a selfless, truly appreciative character. When Small Bright was fighting Gother in the weirdest tournament arc ever, Gother fired at him, and Small Bright used all the energy he can muster in the depths of night for a single attack. And he used it to change the entire flow of the arc, blasting the nearby commandments, letting himself get hit dead on by Gother's weird metaphysical blast thingy. Small Bright doing this revealed the extreme selflessness in his character, the opposite of pride. allowing Gother to attack his memories, being beneficial for Gother, as well as humiliating to himself. But he went a step further and also wiped out the commandments to protect his friends. This attack did not bring him glory. This attack did not prove his dominance. This attack proved exactly to what length he appreciates and respects and cares for his friends. All these things I've just mentioned are the polar opposite to pride. And without this sin of pride, Escanor would be the most exemplary personality in the anime easily. While in his small, bright form, he did not hesitate to hide Ban, Elaine, and one of the most powerful and useful anime characters of all anime. Holy Knight Jericho! He tried to protect them, knowing himself to be completely defenseless to the commandments chasing them at this point in time. If they'd have felt like it, they would have destroyed him in a heartbeat, especially knowing that he was concealing their fugitives. So with complete lack of self-preservation, he went above and beyond the duties of a mere friend, sheltering those he cared about and those that cared about him when he needed it. Every, even slight action we see him take as Small Bright is the polar opposite to any action with even the slightest hint of pride. And that's why he's such a brilliant character. Due to the past traumatic experiences he's faced from his ostracization, where he wasn't accepted anywhere for who he was, there are two types of people to get over that kind of trauma, and two fashions to do so. The person that cries about how the world was unfair to him and feels like a lower level human being. This is the type of person that would fully appreciate anyone who does accept him. And this is the person who would go out of his way to humiliate himself, protecting those he cares about and protecting anyone that could be inflicted by the suffering that he's felt. This is the essence of Small Bright's psychology. The second type of person that walks away from the world who attacked him with nothing but indignation is not to absorb the pain like Small Bright and try to grow past it through making new friends, having new experiences, but someone who attempts to deflect the pain. In this case, doing so by filling oneself with such overwhelming pride, they genuinely feel no emotions to those they deem beneath them. They are merely pitied in the eyes of Tall Bright. This is the main reason why I love his fight against Esterosa. I made an entire video on that fight itself, and I mentioned that this would be the follow-up video, but Esterosa, using a power that prevents anyone with any hatred in their heart to fight him, doesn't cause Escanor to mask his hatred, and therefore fight. In his true heart of hearts, he feels absolutely no hatred towards Esterosa. Just like in the past, he's cut off his potential for love. Tall Bright has no interest in avenging Meliodas, his close friends that recruited him to be a part of their family when he had no one. None of these were thoughts that crossed his mind even slightly, being that he was completely free from the influence of Esterosa's power of love. Any gratitude he harbored towards the rest of the sins was completely overshadowed by pride. Just like throughout the series, we've never actually seen Tall Bright show any appreciation for the action of the sins when he was alone. This is a known psychology for someone who's had trauma, especially based on stigmatizing their outwardness, either through internalizing the pain or externalizing it and pinning it on others. To avoid this mental trauma, Tall Bright has been closed off from both love and hatred of anyone he deems beneath him. And while he's actually Tall Bright, everything is beneath him. This is why I love the dynamic of the dual personalities between Tall Bright and Small Bright. Not only does their entire character change, and not only is it perfectly ideal for the story to have 12 hours a day where Escanor is not all-powerful, which I will be discussing in my Overpowered Weaklings video, that I'm working on comparing him to All Might. But what's truly fascinating is both opposite facets of his philosophy and psychology are retroactively both realistically plausible fashions to get out of a traumatic situation. And each reaction makes sense, especially due to the nature of Tall Bright and Small Bright respectively. So to wrap up my personal take on the matter, while I feel terrible for Small Bright for all the traumatic past he's had, at the same time I find it heartwarming that he managed to actually find people he cares about, and people that care about him. Would he be a shonen protagonist? He would be that traumatic past lonely kid grows up, makes friends, becomes happy Naruto trope guy. But being that he's embedded in the Seven Deadly Sins narrative as a split personality to pride, it doesn't feel like any trope we've ever seen or interacted with so far. In fact, before I started working on this video, I didn't even notice it. And as far as Tall Bright, I have the opposite reaction. It always felt so awesome when he was on screen. I didn't feel bad for him in the slightest. When I heard his backstory and when I heard how he was able to cancel out hatred by pure pride, I thought of him only as badass, but not as a human being. He's one of the saddest characters I've seen in a long time. While in his tall, bright form, we never see him experience joy. The closest thing to that are his polite, pitiful chuckles as he looks down upon the man he's about to completely overpower. He's never revealed to appreciate his surroundings because he's already killed that part of himself. And that comes from his discrimination. All the power in the world won't make him happy. He's not like One Punch Man. Saitama has a goal of seeking strong opponents, and Escanor has no goals. He has no aspirations. Taking discrimination to his head, he thinks of himself as a higher life form and now discriminates against the world. Every line he says as he's fighting reaffirms this position. I don't hate those weaker than me. I merely pity them. Because internally, in his heart, he's a nice guy. He is small, bright. But because pride became his natural defense mechanism, it's not that he thinks weaker beings are completely worthless like many people in position of power do. They're not worthless. They're worth something. They're worth his pity. But if they were to decide anything of value, remember that the only one that gets to decide anything is me, Escanor. And it's this duality of his personality, where each side retroactively is a different psychological countermeasure to his past traumatic experience, based on the individual nature of Small Bright and Tall Might as individual beings, showing how immense power would completely alter someone's entire world perspective. That, in a nutshell, makes the Lion's Den of Pride Escanor one of my favorite anime characters of all time. Oh, and it's of course just freaking badass watching his smug, prideful face annihilate the living schnizzle out of those racist, high horse demon bitches. And let's not forget, there's that aspect too. Beauties and gentle beauties, I hope you enjoyed. I hope maybe you see Escanor in a slightly different bright than you did in the past. If you did, that would be awesome. Feel free to let me know in the comments your thoughts of this type of decoded character video, and if there are any future characters you would like me to talk about philosophically or psychologically. I do have a link in the description to my merch of Orr Bright himself. Would definitely help support the channel if you were to pick one of those up. If you liked the video, feel free to leave a like. You want more deep freaking analyses that no one else really seems to be doing on YouTube, and try not to copy other people's stuff, feel free to subscribe and hit that notification bell, which is the new way to subscribe. Also in the description, link to my Twitter, which is the greatest device for shitposting on the face of the planet. And also in the description, a link to my Patreon. I try to do these deep analysis videos, and they're really hard and long to put together on the research end, aside from the scripting and editing. So the deep analysis stuff really, thanks to the patrons, anyone who can help me there would really be appreciated, and it really helps support the channel. I'm working on an OP analysis on Guts, which is taking its time because I really want to get it right, being that I kind of think no one else on YouTube's done that yet, at least not right. Special thanks to the Swagcoggers, Q, Tyler Schumacher, Zindergarten, Axel, Colton, Scott, and an anonymous member, the three Lord Tweegers, Gavin Anderson, Large Blab, and Ilumsan, and the three Godus Uprank, Dark Element, JD Fincher, and Ezidric. Your support is crucial to this channel's survival, especially with YouTube demonetizing everything. I'm sure you've heard it from other YouTubers. I'm not the first. I won't be the last. In fact, on this video, I'm not expecting to make a lot because apparently YouTube's dubbed the 7 deadly sins as not family friendly, and I'm not really open to divulge numbers, but 7 deadly sins videos make a fifth of what My Hero Academia videos make, for example. So I hope you enjoyed the hell out of this one. Have yourself a most wonderful evening and stay weird, fam. Don't lose your way.